Hey, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Today's July 23rd. This is the Berean Bible Fellowship. And the title of today's sermon is God's Only True Religion. Now, as we continue in our study through the God's Kingdom program, this is this area here. Remember, for the last 2 weeks we've been talking about God's Kingdom. Today we're going to take a look at the only true religion that was created by God. So we're going to view how and why this religion was created and what its purpose was. Now, when God had freed his chosen people from bondage in Egypt, 400 years of bondage, they brought with them many bad habits that they had picked up while they were enslaved. Now think of the African American people. We were enslaved for years in this country. What bad habits did we bring with us out of slavery that some of these things we're still dealing with today? Have you ever heard of them saying, of some black people, that person has a slave's mentality? You ever heard that before? What exactly does that mean? Means that this person, their behavior and their thinking is like a slave. It's dependent. It's thinking that they're less. When I was in school and I was studying psychology, they had what was called secondary deviancy. Secondary deviancy is when a group that is discriminated against starts to believe the stereotypes about them. Let me give you an example. When I was growing up in North Syracuse, my father was a very strict person. He made sure that we went to school. We used slang, and he corrected that immediately. So we were always very articulate, all my brothers and sisters. But when we moved from North Syracuse to the city, we were told that we spoke like white people. Because we didn't have that city slang that was common to the city area, the things that we grew up out in the suburbs. But it took me years to deal with that and to come to peace with that I wasn't acting out of my race or out of my people's color because I was articulate. And I finally understood that the people who were trying to put that down upon me were practicing secondary deviancy. That it was that many people were told, well, black people are stupid.
Yeah.
They're uneducated. So when they saw somebody who was educated, they were like, well, you're not acting black, because what I've been told, even though you were black, you were told that black people aren't smart. Black people aren't articulate. And that was something that many blacks brought with them out of slavery. Another thing that we brought out of slavery with us was eating pork and eating the worst parts of the pig, the hooves, the pig's feet, the chitlins, and things like this. These were things that the slave owners gave to the blacks. That was the waste of the pig, and they gave that to blacks, and we had a diet of that. And that came with us out of slavery and has come all the way still until today. Now, what effects did that have? You ever heard that blacks are more susceptible to high blood pressure?
Yeah.
It's true. It's because of the diet and some of the practices that we brought with us out of slavery. Now, I use that as an example because when the Hebrews came out of 400 years of slavery, they brought some bad habits with them. God was silent for 400 years. So Egypt and Pharaoh had multiple gods that they worshipped. And when the Hebrews were freed and they got out to the wilderness and they were challenged, what was the first thing they did? They turned to the false gods. Aaron built the calf. Even though they were on the Mount of Sinai and they're waiting for Moses to come back, chatter started. secession started, and they turned back to what they had known for the last 400 years. So God saw that it was necessary to give them guidance. Another thing that had happened was that when Adam and Eve sinned, the veil came down. They no longer shared the relationship that was created with God. God now had to operate with them from behind the veil to protect His own holiness. His holiness is perfect, and it cannot be infected by the sin nature. And even when Christ was on the cross and He was bearing the sins of the world, He cried out, my God, God the Father, my God the Holy Spirit, why have you separated from me?" Because God is just and God is holy, and He had to separate from sin. So now the veil is down. So now Israel needs some type of way to worship God, to have some type of relationship with God. So God creates a religion for them. In Exodus 19, 5 through 6, it says, "Now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people. For all the earth is mine, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel." This is the message that God gave to Moses when he was up on the mountain all those days when they were waiting for him to come back. So he came back and he presented to the nation of Israel. And Cecil B. DeMille, the man who made the movie The Ten Commandments, he did us all kind of an injustice, because he presents it that Moses comes down and he's just got the Ten Commandments. Ten Commandments are kind of like cliff notes. Okay, the most important of the 613 laws that he gave Moses up on that mountain. And when Moses came back, he presented these 613 laws to the nation of Israel. And God first offered them grace. He said, "Don't you remember how I bore you on eagle's wings, and how I did with the Egyptians?" In other words, how I brought them to their knees to release you. That was me doing that. "And I bore you on eagle wings. I brought you out to the wilderness. I fed you with manna. I did everything for you. Let's continue in this." So God offers the nation of Israel grace. They took law. They saw the 613 laws and they said, "This we will do." So they now have what's called a conditional covenant. And you remember back here when we talked of Abraham, what kind of covenant did God make with Abraham? Do we remember? He made an unconditional covenant with Abraham. Remember, he said, "Abraham, I will do this. I will give you a son. I will give you land. I will give you a kingdom. I will give you descendants numbered as the stars." God is saying, "I will do, I will do, I will do." He never said anything to Abraham, "If you do this, then I will do this." Okay, so that is an unconditional covenant, meaning it is totally dependent upon God. But this covenant is different, because God is telling them, "If you follow my commandments, then you will be a peculiar people unto me." So you have these 613 laws. Now, the 613 laws of the Mosaic Law were split into three different categories. You had ceremonial law, which told them how to operate the temple, how to properly worship God. Because remember, where are we? We're on this side of the veil. And in the temple, you had what was called the Holies of Holies. When Moses came down from the mountain with those tablets, the Ten Commandments, they went into the Ark of the Covenant. Remember that, the golden chest that they carried. And why did they carry it with poles? because it was so holy, they weren't allowed to touch it. If they touched it, God told them, if you touch it, you will die. So only the Levite priest carried it with poles, and it was in the Holy of Holies inside the temple. And there was a back room there in the temple, and then the veil was across it. And only the Levite priest could go back. Only those from Aaron's family, his descendants, were allowed to operate the temple. God had selected out one tribe, and they acted as the priesthood. Does that sound familiar? So they acted as the priesthood. They did all the ceremonies. They did the Passover, the sacrifice for atonement. They did all these sacrifices. They did everything that happened in the temple. They did. So someone like, Joshua, I don't know what tribe he was from, but it wasn't the Levites. As blessed and as favored as Joshua was, Joshua couldn't go into the Holy of Holies. It was reserved for only the Levite priesthood. So God was very specific who could do what. And everything that was inside the temple, the length of the curtain, the color of it, how many rings it had, everything was very specific. And this was part of the physical manifestation that God was giving them in teaching them how to worship. Now, the next section of the Mosaic Law was moral law. How we are to treat each other, how we are to interact with each other. Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal. These are all moral codes that you're to live by. And then they had judicial law. So the Mosaic Law is split up into all these three parts, giving you very specific instruction how to live your life, how to live with each other, and how to worship God. This was the only religion that was created by God. Now we have many religions out here. What is the difference between Catholicism or Protestants and Judaism? What is the difference? I mean, we have water baptism. Judaism has it. Baptists have it. What is the difference? The difference is God instructed in Judaism to do this. In Protestantism, they stole it from Judaism. It was directed to the Jew during this time period and during this time period only. During this time period and this time period, which is, you bring them together, it's supposed to be one time period. So many of the practices that we have in different religions now were taken from Judaism. And we're taken from the instruction to Judaism, to the Hebrews, and how to worship God. It was that physical manifestation that was promised. During this time, they had animal sacrifice because the perfect sacrifice had not come.
Amen.
And they needed, in order to have some type of relationship with God, sin had to be dealt with back here. So an animal was sacrificed, and a delay in judgment was given.
Praise God. Amen.
Okay? We don't need a delay in judgment. Our sin has been judged for once and for all.
Praise God.
It is not an issue anymore. Where back here, they had to atone for their sin every year. And then the Levite priest had to go behind that curtain, and he sprinkled the blood of the sacrifice on the mercy seat. And that gave them atonement. And before he went behind that curtain, he had to wash himself. He had to baptize himself. That's one of the 14 baptisms. So everything in this religion was created by the Almighty, and they were instructed to do. Whereas we are not instructed to do all these things. We are not the nation of Israel. And this is the importance of right division, so that you're getting proper instruction and doing proper things, and you understand what was for Israel and what is for the body of Christ. Now, salvation was not by the law. None of these practices, nothing in the Mosaic law, delivered salvation to them. And in Romans 8:34, it said, "For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit."
Praise God.
So salvation was delivered to those under the law, exclusively. God made this program, created a people, and gave salvation to them under the law, meaning that you had to be a Jew in order to get salvation. That's where salvation was. You had to come in under the law. You had to be circumcised. You had to identify with the Mosaic law. And that's how you obtain salvation. So when some people confuse sometimes and say, well, if they had to be under the law, then it's a law that's delivering salvation. No. It's like saying, in order to get lumpia, you got to come to Raquel's house. That's where lumpia is served.
Yes.
It's not served at Michael's house.
No.
Okay. So you had to come to the house of Israel to attain salvation.
Amen.
Okay? So when God created Judaism as a religion for the nation of Israel, he was teaching them how to worship. He was leading them, delivering atonement for their sin and delaying judgment, allowing the nation of Israel access to the throne of God through the Levite priesthood.
Amen.
So everything was very direct, very exact, very particular. Now, the law represented what perfect righteousness is. And it was a guide that you can't do it without God. No one could keep the whole law. We are sin. We have an old sin nature. So thus we can't do it. And this was a schoolmaster to teach us that you can't do it on your own. It's kind of like when we were younger, my father would teach us how to swim. And he had a habit of throwing us in the pool, which showed us, you can't swim, you need me to teach you. That was a lesson quickly learned. So, not many of my brothers and sisters, none of us walked over towards the water. We knew if we were going over towards the water, we were probably going in. Okay, you know, you yell at kids sometimes, stay away from the water. Or it's kind of like that kid who sits there and keeps playing with the stove. You let him burn himself one time, and he doesn't touch it anymore, does he? Okay, so God was teaching us that we could not do this. They could not do this on their own. They needed a Savior.
Amen. Praise God.
They needed a Savior. Okay? So when Jesus Christ confronted Saul of Tarsus on the road to Damascus, he saved Saul and created in Christ a new program, something different. Something different from here. God said, you don't have to come to Raquel's house anymore to get lumpia. You can get it everywhere. Everybody can get it. You don't have to be of her family. And you didn't have to be of the nation of Israel. Now, the nation of Israel and Gentiles, there's no difference. They're the same. God isn't just dealing with the nation of Israel anymore. And now the religion of Judaism is no longer needed. It's no longer needed. So the sacrifice of the animals is no longer needed. Circumcision is no longer needed. There was what's called the middle wall of partition when God gave the covenant of circumcision to Abraham. And he gave him the covenant of circumcision, and he said, do this to all your family, your servants, everybody. That is the mark that you are an Israelite, that you are under the promise, and God is dealing with you. He's dealing with this family. So that stayed up all the way through here until they stoned Stephen. Then that middle wall of partition came down. Now God is dealing with the whole world. He now has salvation for all. Now, a Gentile could be saved back here. They had to become a Jew. They had to become a Jew in order. So God's love is complete. God didn't say, okay, I'm just forgetting you Gentiles. I have nothing for you. But they had to come in under the promise that he had made to Abraham. He said, this is how salvation, we're going to deal with this people. So you had to become that part of that people in order to have access to God's promise. But now, he's opened it up. There is no difference. And salvation is available to all.
Praise God.
Amen. So, there was much conflict about the change in program. Saul of Tarsus, God changes Saul's name to Paul and reveals to him the mystery, this area here. And this doctrine states that there is no Jew, there's no Gentile, as we said. And in Gentile, in Galatians 3:28, Paul says that there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. Why do you think he said there's neither male nor female? Why do you think he made that distinction? Under this program, men were recognized. If you look at the genealogy of Jesus Christ in the Old Testament or in the Gospels, it always says, you have this man, this man, this man, this man was the son of this one, this one was the son of this one. When Christ fed 5,000 with a fish and 3 loaves of bread, that count was just the men. They just counted the men. So, women and children weren't counted there. So, when it says he fed 5,000, this might be more like 10. 10th of them. You had wives, you had children. But men were only recognized here. Here, God is saying everybody's recognized. Women are recognized. And women had salvation back here. I don't want to sit there and have somebody say, okay, women weren't saved. Women were saved. It's just that God recognized the man.
Amen.
Here, he recognizes all. He recognizes your, because now you have an individual relationship with Christ. And that's why Christianity is not called a religion. It's called a personal relationship with our Creator. Where here, you had to have corporate acceptance. The whole nation of Israel was to accept Christ. Here, it is on you and you alone.
Yeah.
What decision do you make, whether you accept him or not?
Under grace.
Okay? So, many cursed Paul and disregarded his teachings. And in this, they clutch onto a religion created for the nation of Israel, and they try to drag it forward.
Amen.
And this wasn't the first, we think about now, but back during Acts chapter 15, it talks about the council at Jerusalem, where you had Jews that were trying to impose the Mosaic law upon the new converted Gentiles. And they were telling them, you must be circumcised. But remember, what was circumcision for? It was back here to say that God was only dealing with that created people. So they were trying to take that and bring it here, even though God says, I'm dealing with everybody now.
Amen.
They were saying, well, we want to drag this forward to here. Isn't that crazy? that you're dragging, when God has made a covenant and he's made it for a limited period of time and a limited people, but you want to drag it forward to everybody. Could it be that the Jews didn't want to let go of their favorite status?
Yeah.
Okay? So you hear the arguments and the debates that we have now. Could you imagine the debates that Paul was going through back then? Bringing this new program saying that you will no longer have your favored status that you had. You will no longer be that peculiar people. And why aren't they the peculiar people? Because they didn't follow God's commandments. Remember, this is a conditional covenant. They failed. They rejected their Messiah. They're going to be the peculiar people here when every Jew knows Christ and they will follow his commandments. This is when they'll be the peculiar people, because when God makes a promise, God keeps it.
Amen.
He keeps it. Yes. He's made them a promise and he's going to bring them to where they'll keep it.
Amen.
He's going to bring it down to a remnant. They will all accept him. Then every Jew will know him.
Amen.
Amen. So, what would they be saying if they were to conform, if we were to conform to the Jewish ceremony of circumcision? This is how proselytes were accepted into the nation of Israel. I'm sorry, I just went over that. So, was the matter resolved at the Council of Jerusalem? They came together. And Paul and Titus presented the gospel that they were preaching. And the Jews presented the gospel that they were preaching. And in Galatians 2:6 it says, but of these who seem to be somewhat, whatsoever they were, it maketh no matter to me. God accepteth no man's person.
Amen.
But they who seem to be somewhat in conference added nothing to me. But contrary wise, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me, as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter. Now, the King James is definitely the best translation.
Amen.
But it is old world. So I want to break this down into modern West Side language. Okay? So when he says, but of these who seem to be somewhat, whosoever they were, it maketh no matter to me. In other words, in order to those who thought they knew what they were talking about, but don't, they didn't really matter to me. Paul saying, I'm dealing off of a revelation straight from God. I know what I'm talking about. They don't know what they're talking about. Okay? So then he says, for they who seem to be somewhat in conference added nothing to me. In other words, all these people are sitting around and they're trying to figure out what's going on and what we should be doing, what we shouldn't be doing. They add nothing to my conversation. God has given me a program and this is what's supposed to be done. Paul, many people say that Paul sounds so arrogant, that he sounds so sure of himself. You know somebody sometimes. In our culture now, when somebody is dogmatic, and they speak with such authority, sometimes people see them like, who does he think he is? Who does he think he's so arrogant? I'm quite sure that that's what they said about Paul. But you know how they say that God puts leaders in places for certain times? I truly believed, and many may disagree with me, especially. I truly believe that God put George Bush in the place that he did for what happened in 9/11. That's my personal thought. Okay? But many times, God put Hitler in place and allowed him to rise to power. Just as he put Pharaoh in place so that God's might could be showed through him. So God raises in leaders. And I believe that God put Paul in his place for the particular reason that how strong of a personality would you have to have in order to bring about a new program to tell your own people you are no longer have favored status? That favored status that you have enjoyed all this time. And remember what the Gentiles, what the Jews called the Gentiles, they called them dogs. They're dogs. So they looked down upon them. They wanted no part of them. And now here comes a new program where he's saying these people are also included. And Paul had to convince and teach this. So there at the Council of Jerusalem, he's going back and forth in debate with them. And the final decision was that he went to the pillars of the faith. He went to Peter. He went to James, Jesus Christ's half-brother. And he went to John, the beloved. And they said, you will take the gospel of the uncircumcision. And we will continue in the gospel of the circumcision.
Amen.
They took the gospel of the kingdom that was exclusively for Israel. Paul took the gospel of grace.
Amen.
Which is to everybody. And which is salvation by grace without the law. The kingdom is under the law.
Amen.
And they took the religion of Judaism. There is no religion. There is no need for religion. We have a personal relationship with our Creator. So how do we in the body of Christ drag the religion of Judaism into the gospel of grace? Because that's what we do. They had circumcision. We have water baptism. They had animal sacrifice. We have communion.
Yeah.
They had repentance. We have confession. They had idolatry. Some of us pray to Mary.
Still idolatry. Yeah.
They had the Levite priesthood. We have the Catholic priesthood.
Yeah.
Where the priest will sit there and tell you that he can absolve your sin. What blasphemy.
Yeah, it's blasphemous.
Oh. No man can absolve sin. No man other than Jesus Christ on the cross. No man can forgive you of your sin. And you need not confess your sins to any man. Jesus Christ paid for it. Done deal.
Amen.
And in Galatians 5, 2 through 6, it says, "Behold, I, Paul, pray unto you, that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised, that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Christ has become of no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. For we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love. Ye did run well, who did not hinder you that ye should not obey the truth." So when you get the truth, you need to do something with it. You can't get the truth and just decide to shell it. And if you want to continue on in the religion of Judaism, understand it avails you nothing. You're running on a treadmill, you're going nowhere. And there's no reward for it. Because it is said that for grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Amen.
And if you haven't heard the gospel before, understand that you must believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ.
Amen.
So that is the only gospel that we are saved by today.
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
Right. And let's go ahead and close up in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the many blessings that you've given us. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that you've given us instruction and guidance, Father, where the nation of Israel had had the Mosaic Law, we have the Holy Spirit to guide us to all truth. And that you've given us that which is so much better. Salvation by grace, not by works. We thank you for this, Father. Father, help us to be ambassadors for Christ. Help us to spread your word and to spread your message, Father, to all that will listen. Give us the grace that you imputed to us. Give us the perfect righteousness of Christ. And we thank you for all the blessings. And protect us throughout this week, Father, and help us to come back Wednesday for Bible study. And in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen.
I'm sorry, we'll have Galatians 5.
Galatians 5.